we'll see. Ah, yes. Is it Okay, so what I want to do is to go a bit farther, and actually what I'm going to say is... So what I want to do is to move on with the dynamical analysis that we started yesterday. And what I'm going to say is deeply connected with what Florent just told us. So let's start again from the equations that I wrote yesterday. So we had three equations, one for the correlation as a function of time. I just rewrite it, but you should have it. Now I just denote f of x, x cubed over 2. Okay. So that's correlation. Then we have response. Delta. And then we have the this Lagrange multiplier that is just fixed by this. And then I told you yesterday that if you, so these are the equations for gradient descent, and now if you want to look at what happens when you add a bit of temperature, then the only thing that changes is just that you add here T. Okay, and I will do the analysis with T because it's kind of easier. So let me just start by telling you what's the solution, how the solution looks like. So imagine that we look at C of T and T prime. So let me plot it as C of T, T prime, for different T prime. So I fix, let's say that we fix T prime. So how do I do it? So let me say that I do, okay, T prime plus tau and T prime. So I fix T prime, and then I just plot this as a function of tau. Okay? So what's this? This is the correlation of the configuration of the system at time T prime with the system at time T prime plus tau. Okay? So when tau is equal to 0, I am on the sphere, so this is 1. And then what does it do? So if t prime is fixed, then it will do something like this, and then it will go down. Okay, so let me, okay. And then it will decay. So this means that as soon as tau grows, you decorrelate with the initial configuration. Okay, now when you take t prime that becomes larger and larger, this happens to appear to decorrelate at later times. Okay, so this is for T prime that increases. And the reason why this happens, you understand from the picture that I was drawing yesterday for the complexity that Florent just discussed. So this is the threshold energy. So what happens is that your dynamics start from a random point, and then it just descend on saddles. And then the saddles are such that if you look to the spectrum of the Hessian, so at the beginning the spectrum is like this. So this is rho of lambda as a function of lambda. And then when the dynamics run, then the spectrum just shifts. Oops. And then this happens just approaching this threshold value. Okay. So as soon that, as this happens, what happens is that these negative directions in the Hessian, so their number is smaller and smaller. So you approach, let's say, some kind of minimum. But in order to find it, it takes longer and longer. So you move slower and slower. And that's what is called aging. Okay. And so the idea is that at very long times, you get stuck there. So is there a way we can plug this physical picture inside those equations and extract this? Yes? It's just that I called, it is going to be erased 30, yeah? Let's leave it. So I call MR TT prime. This is F second TT prime R TT prime and MC TT prime F prime C TT prime. And F, if you take this F, then you get exactly the same expression. Okay, it's just now I just denote F as this because what you can do is that instead of taking a pure p spin, you can take a mixture, and the only thing that changes is just this function. So if you take, for example, an Hamiltonian that is just like so you have a three spin I J K J I J K sigma j sigma k plus I don't know something else ij I don't know, and actually we will have it later, and these two are just different random variables, so let me say this is j3 and this is j2, then the only thing that changes is this form. Okay, so we'll have x squared divided by something depending on the normalization. So if you just have this function, then this corresponds to a class of models. And actually, you can have even a series of terms, and you can construct a functional, a random functional. Okay, that is not just a random polynomial. Okay. So the idea is how to try to extract this physical picture from those equations. And this is something that was done in a breakthrough by Kuliandro and Kurchan. In 95. And it's really a beautiful paper. It's something that when you read it, it opens your mind, actually. It's really beautiful. So what did they do? So they say, OK, so what you see here is that you have a dynamics that is going on, let's say, kind of two time scales. So you have a first time scale where the correlation just decays on this plateau. OK, and then you have a much longer time scale where the correlation decays. So can we have can we plug this separation of time scales in the solution? Yes?
Why is the Hessian GOE? Is it obvious?
Sorry?
Why is the Hessian GOE? Is it obvious or?
Well, yes. It's not obvious, but if you just compute the correlations between the elements of the Hessian, then you just see that it's GOE. Okay. So all the cross correlations and higher correlations, they are negligible in 1 over n.
And which has a bias with energy?
Sorry?
Which has a bias, so it moves if you move an
energy. Yeah, so the Hessian, so this is, is equal to sum over k mu, that is the same mu that you have there, delta ij. Okay, so you have some random term plus a shift that is just there to enforce that you are on the sphere. Okay, so how can we plug this thinking inside those equations? So if you think about this, let's say, two-time regime scenario, you have a first-time regime that is fast, and then you have a much longer time regime. So you can say, OK, let me say that this correlation function, tt prime, so let me assume that t and t prime are very large, so they are going to infinity. Okay? So I'm in a regime in which I have that this time scale where I start to decay from the plateau is well separated from this fast decay. Okay? And so what you can say is that, okay, in this time regime, I can have a first fast decay, and I will comment, and then I will have a long time behavior. I just write and then explain. That depends in a different way from time. Okay, so let me explain. So this fast decay regime, you can think that it's like going very fast, very, very close to this point. So I'm very close to a minimum. And so if I'm very close to a minimum, I can expect that if I have a minimum, and then there are very few negative directions, I explore almost in a quasi-equilibrium fashion the properties of this minimum. Okay? And so this very fast regime is like relaxation into a minimum. And since it's relaxation into a minimum, you can expect that there is some kind of equilibrium properties of this minimum that appear. So the correlation function should depend, for example, on time differences. That is what happens when you are in equilibrium. Okay. So when the time t prime is large, then you are just inside the equilibrium, the restricted equilibrium in this state. And then on much longer time scales, you find these negative directions, and then you have an additional contribution at long time scales. Okay. So what happens is that since you are in a minimum, if you look to the correlation between two configurations that are well separated in time, this correlation should not decay to zero because you are in a restricted minimum, right? And this correlation is what? It's just this plateau. Okay. So this thing for t minus t prime going to infinity should be finite. It's not zero. Okay? It's how much two typical configurations inside this minimum resemble each other. And then, of course, on much longer time scales, you start from q. That's why you have q here. And then you start decay. Okay? And then so here, this thing depends on t minus t prime. And here, of course, you are in a different time regime in which t prime is much smaller than t. And so everything is depends on this lambda that goes from 1 to 0. Okay, so it's okay. No, it's not this case, but it's a variable that goes from 1 where you are at t equal to t prime, so where you are in this regime, and then it decays to 0 when t is much, much larger than t prime. Okay, so this is an ansatz for c. And now let me consider the ansatz for R. Okay. So this is what? So if I have a short time regime, where short time is, it means that t prime has gone to infinity. So I'm exploring this minima in quasi equilibrium. But the difference is finite. Since I'm exploring this in a quasi equilibrium fashion, you should have that the response is related to the correlation function. And actually, there is a theorem that works for systems that are in equilibrium that tells you that the response is given by the correlation function this way. So you have where t is the temperature. Okay. So on this time regime, the response is related to the correlation function. And then you have another time regime that depends on another function. Again, as a function of t over t prime over t, that again is lambda. Okay? So the idea, again, the deep idea is that when t prime and t are going to infinity, the dynamics is, you have to think that the dynamics is a relaxation to the minimum and the exploration in a quasi-equilibrium fashion of this minimum. And then on very long time scales, you just drift away. So it's like jumping very, very close to this minima and then just surfing on this landscape of marginally stable minima. So this is the fast relaxation, and then this is the surf on these threshold states. Okay, now what they did is that they plugged these ansatz inside those equations and found the equation for this, and for this. Okay, so I will not, maybe I will just show how you have to do in one of the three, and then I will write the results for all the other two, just to try to understand how it works. So you just need to look at these equations, and then you have a bunch of integrals, and then you need to understand how to compute those integrals using these ansatz. Okay, so for example, here you see that you have an integral over this time variable, and then it will have two regimes, one in which this time variable, for example, is close to t, one is close to t prime, and so on. And you need to separate all the contributions. Okay, let me do it for mu. And then I will tell you how it works for the others, but maybe I will not give you all the details. Anyway, the paper, I mean, it's you can really follow all the details, and it's beautiful. Okay, so you have this, so I can maybe erase because I want to use those equations. So imagine that I look at mu. So this is a one-time quantity. So when I take t and t prime that goes to infinity, you expect that this goes to a number. Okay, it's a constant. So for t that goes to infinity, mu of t goes to mu infinity, that is t that is this temperature. And then you have these two integrals, okay? Okay, now, oops, this is t. Now you see that there are two regimes. So let me consider this integral, for example. So there are two regimes. There is a regime in which s is very close to t, and t is large. Okay, so I'm taking the t to infinity limit. And then there is a regime where s is far away from t. So I can just rewrite this. So first let me, okay, maybe I can simplify this. So I can just write this as, this. And so what do I have? I have a first term . So let me use the fact that when s is close to t, I am in this FDT regime where the fluctuation dissipation theorem holds, so I can relate response to correlation. And so I can just write this regime as 1 over t. Let me write this way. Okay, so I just use the fact that the response here is obtained as the derivative of the correlation function. Okay, and then I have another regime, which is 1 over t. Okay. So now this I can integrate out because I can use just compute the integral. So this is just t, and then I have plus 1 over t f prime. And now I just remember that this is a function of the time difference. From 0 to t plus, then this is just the integral between 0 and 1 in this variable lambda, that is just this ratio of . Okay, so of course this is just so why q? Because the long tail limit, when this thing diverges, so when I compute this at s equal to 0, this is cf dt of t, and t is diverging. So it's just the long time limit of the first regime, the short time regime. And you know that this this limit corresponds to the thing when you take the tau to infinity limit of this part. And so this gives q. It's the plateau of the correlation function. Okay. And so you have an expression for this constant. And you see that this expression depends on the long time limit of the short time behavior of correlation function, and then you have a full part that depends on the aging regime. So this long time regime. Yes. Ah, yes, you're right.
So also,
sorry. Yeah, it's here. Where?
On the update of the correlation function.
No, but wait, here it's...
Yeah, and it comes as well from the screen.
Let me see. Did I make mistakes? Yeah, so here you have a C.
Yeah.
And then here there is a C, you're right. So actually this is TS, T prime S. And here it's C, right? Now wait, this is... No, this is R. Yes. This is R. Yeah, sorry. So there is a C factor that is missing here. Oops. And here. Okay. This is Q, C aging S over T. And then there is a factor here. It's Q. Okay, so that's for example what happens for mu. Okay, I need to go. And then what you do is that you plug the ansatz inside those two equations, and then you want to get an equation for the FDT regime, and then you want to get the equations for the aging regime. So it's a scaling solution, so you need to compute the scaling equations for the scaling functions. Okay, so that's mu. And okay, I just plug the result. Maybe so you just need to analyze those integrals exactly with the same method. Okay, so let me assume that t and t prime are going to infinity, but t minus t prime is of order 1. Okay. So what's this equation? It's just the derivative with respect to time. And here I take mu infinity because I'm taking this limit. And then I have the contribution for this from this this integral. And you can compute it exactly using exactly the same thing that we did before. And this is just given by 1 over t. There is a q here. Okay, maybe I will just skip this. Okay, let me write it. So it's 1 over t. Now I just And then you have another term that comes from the full history, that is and that's exactly the same as we had before for mu. Now, so let's use this equation to compute the value of this plateau of Q. So what we want to do is that we want to take the limit where t minus t prime goes to infinity. So in this limit, this function plateaus, so this derivative is just zero. Okay. And so this gives you an equation for mu infinity. So this gives zero equal to minus mu infinity q, and then I'm using that this goes to q. And then we have this term, okay, that stays the same. And then we have the limit, oops, this is the prime. Of this integral. Of this one. Okay. And now since here you have a derivative, this is going to be different than zero only when s is close to t. Okay. And just doing this you can show that this thing you get that this is equal to q over t okay. So you have an expression in terms of q. Okay. So we had an expression for mu infinity. This is a relation for q. Okay. And then we want to mix them. So you see that this expression depends on this integral. And then if you look at the equation that I wrote for mu infinity, you find exactly the same integral. So you can express this term. As okay, and then you can plug this inside the equation. Okay, and then if you plug it inside the equation, you get that mu infinity, which is a very important quantity because it enters in the Hessian at long times. It's t over 1 minus q. Over t. Okay. So of course this is not the full story because you see that this depends on q. And so we need to determine q. And so what you can do is that you can take the ansatz that I wrote before and now look at the case in which t minus t prime is infinite and instead t over t prime is finite. Okay. Okay. So if you do that, what happens is that on this time scale, essentially these terms disappear because you are on such long time scales and the dynamics is so slow that these two derivatives can just be neglected. So you have a system of equations in which you replace here 0 and 0, and then you need to evaluate this on this time regime. Okay. Now it turns out that when you take these equations and you remove these derivatives, those equations are start to become very interesting because they are reparametrization invariant. So which means that if you look at a solution of t and t prime, and you define a function, let me call h of t, that is increasing with time, it's monotonously increasing with time, then also this is a solution of the equations. So you can just assume that you have a solution, consider a transformation that is just a stretching of the real line. Okay. You plug it in the solution, then you plug this inside those equations, the same for R, and then you get exactly zero. So the equations are satisfied. So these equations have a symmetric group, and they're said to be reparametrization invariant. So this is interesting because even if in very recently, there are models in quantum mechanics that essentially have exactly the same properties. And these models are very close to the p-spin that we are studying. They are quantum version of the p-spin. And there, people there are interested to those models because essentially they have this property. Okay. Now, of course, you see that this symmetry should be broken because you have just one solution. If you just run the equations, you solve them numerically, you don't have a family of solutions. You have just one. So it turns out that this symmetry should be broken. And how it is broken? It is broken by these two terms. Okay. So it's like having a Mexican hat in which you have a very small symmetry breaking field that is provided by these two terms. And this symmetry breaking field selects one solution. So you have just one solution for this. But in order to compute it, you need to match this long time regime with the short time one. That is exactly where these two derivatives kick in. And actually, this is what is called the velocity selection problem. And this is something that is like you typically see when you try to compute scaling solutions of PDEs. And actually, in synthesis, one example is the KPP equation. It is also called Fisher equation. Am I spelling it right? Yes. And for example, if you consider this PDE, and I don't know if you have ever seen it, but this is a PDE that is modeling the invasion of a stable phase into an unstable one. So you have like fronts that moves. And if you try to compute the asymptotic form of this front, you see that this equation is such that you can plug whatever velocity for the front, But of course, the dynamics just selects one value of the velocity. And that's the velocity selection problem. And this was studied a long time ago, not long, so long, but Langer and D. And there are a lot of works by Van Sarlos and so on. So this is a widespread problem, okay? And in this case, it's unclear how to do the proper velocity selection. Okay, but anyway, you forget about trying to fix the solution, and you just try to compute the scaling equation for the aging part and the aging part of the response. Okay, for example, you start with the response. And then what you find, if you just plug the answers, I just tell you what's the result, you find this equation. It's a bit complicated. And then I hope that it's correct. But in the paper it's written correct. Anyway, apart from this factor, so you see that you have an equation. And now you say the following. Okay, let me try to see what happens if I take lambda that goes to 1. So this corresponds to take t and t prime that are always large, but t prime over t that is 1. Okay, so I'm matching the two regimes. So of course this integral is not there, okay, because I'm taking this limit. And the only thing that is left is just this term. Now, this solution has either a trivial equation, this equation has either a trivial solution, that is when this term is equal to 0, and this corresponds to, let's say, a kind of high temperature solution, because it tells you don't have anything more after the short time regime, or it has a solution only if this term vanishes. Okay? So if you want to have aging, so this is just telling you that, okay, but if I'm arriving to this plateau, this equation is telling me, okay, if you want to have a regime after this plateau, you just need to enforce that this thing is zero. Okay, this term in the bracket is zero. Okay. And so you plug it. And so you see that you have another equation that depends on mu infinity and q. And we had an equation for mu infinity that I wrote before. So you have two equations with two unknowns that are mu infinity and q. And then you can solve it. And so what you get an equation for q that is that is this. So you can just do the details. Okay, so this is marginal stability, and I will tell you why. So if you compute mu infinity from here, okay, so let me first say the following. So this is an equation that holds for at finite temperature. Okay, let me take the zero temperature limit. So I'm just doing gradient descent. And of course, what happens is that, so what is this Q? This Q is the amplitude of, so I'm this Q tells you how much two configurations look each other when you sample them from the minimum. And when the temperature is going to zero, of course you are just going down to the minimum. So this Q should scale as 1, because when you go to the minimum, you just take one configuration, minus some function, some quantity, some constant, that I call Ka, times the temperature. So when T goes to 0, I expect this to happen. Okay, it's just saying that I have harmonic vibrations inside one minimum. And then if I plug this here, I just get 1 over chi square Ea. Okay. And then if you plug this into the zero temperature limit for mu infinity, you get this. Okay, so I want to jump on this and then come back. Now, let me discuss what are the physical consequences of this. So let me come back to the Hessian. Yes? Can you explain again?
Yeah, Q equal to 1 minus chi.
This thing?
Yes.
So imagine that you are in a minimum and you are at finite temperature. So the system is just moving around. And so Q tells you how much two typical configurations sampled from the equilibrium distribution inside this minimum resemble each other. So it's, if I extract two configurations, one here and one there, this is Q. Okay, it's not Q, but it's if I extract two configurations, their overlap is Q, so how much they are similar. And so when I go down inside the minimum and I lower the temperature, of course, these two configurations become closer and closer because I have a minimum. So in the end, when the temperature is zero, the two configurations are just the configuration of the system in the minimum. So this thing should go to 1. Okay. And so how does it do? Well, it just do like this. Okay, it's an assumption, but it's not. So you can see that this thing scales when Q goes to. So you clearly see that T, 1 minus Q over T, appears directly. And actually, you can show that, if you have an harmonic minimum, that's if you want an exercise, but if you have an harmonic minimum, Q is this. So this is a susceptibility. Yes. When you decrease the temperature, this goes to 1. Okay? You never, of course, so what happens is that this goes, so as soon as you lower the temperature, you have this. And then you lower again the temperature, you have this. And so on. Okay? No, yeah, you stay. You always need to think that you are sending T prime to infinity. So all this picture is for this thing when T prime is going to infinity. So if you have finite T prime, of course you decay. Okay, even at zero temperature. If I run gradient descent, I move. So I need to decorrelate in a sense. And one underlying assumption is that you decorrelate. But when I take T prime that is going to infinity, I'm looking at the system at large times. It's not when the dynamics started. So I'm moving, and then I fix this time, T prime, and then I ask myself, how much do I move? and you don't move much. The lower the temperature. Now, this result is super important because let me discuss the action. Okay, now I can erase all this and the technical part is finished. And now we discuss the physics. Now, if I take the action, I think I wrote it several times. So it's it's k, aijk, sigma k, plus mu infinity, delta ij. So I'm looking at the properties of a typical minimum that is reached during when I arrive at the end point of the gradient descent. Now let me compute the variance of this object. So this is k prime and you see that again I use the fact that this thing concentrates, and so this k, you have just one relevant term, that is when k is equal to k prime. Okay, and so this is and let me rewrite 3 as f second of 1 over n. So of course, this thing should scale like 1 over n. It's a random matrix. So it's a n times n random matrix. Okay. So you can assume that you have a GOE matrix with this variance for the elements. And so the if I just look at this matrix, this one, this is a semicircle with a spectrum that is between minus 2 square root of f second of 1 and 2. Okay. Now, if I add that term on the diagonal, the spectrum just shifts. So the spectrum of this full matrix is between now, if you use this result, it tells you that the spectrum is a semicircle that touches 0. Okay. Okay. So the thing is that this scaling analysis predicts that the dynamics land on these marginally stable states. Okay, I'm very. And actually, this is something that is very important, and it happens in many problems. Okay. So this analysis actually tells you a lot of other things. So you can go a bit forward, and actually you can show that this response function, when you are in the aging regime, is connected to the correlation in a way that is similar to the short time regime. Actually, you have. So let me write it properly. So this is x q c prime. Or lambda. So this is like FDT, and actually it's called quasi FDT. And it tells you that when you land on these marginally stable states, you don't have actually equilibrium because you are aging, so the dynamics is out of equilibrium. But within this out of equilibrium regime, you have some kind of quasi-equilibrium property. So you have a relation that is like a relation that you have in equilibrium. It's a modification of the fluctuation dissipation theorem. And actually, this parameter here, x, is connected to what Floran was discussing before. What is this parameter? So if I plot the complexity as a function of, let me plot it as a function of the energy. I have something like this. These are the threshold states. And then if I look at the slope of this curve here, then this slope is just the limit of x over t when t okay, so I have a solution at finite temperature that depends on this thing that I can compute within the answers that Juliano and Kurcher made. And when I take the zero temperature limit, I get a number. And this number is just the slope of this curve here. Okay. And actually, there is a beautiful interpretation of all this. I mean, this is telling you a lot on the out of equilibrium dynamics, because this tells you that when you are in this long time regime, you are just making kind of the statistical mechanics of all the minima that are here. Okay, you are surfing on those minima, and then you are sampling them with an effective temperature that is that one that corresponds to the slope of this curve here. Okay, so. Okay, so is this the full story? Actually, no. So the take-home message here is that the gradient descent dynamics is attracted by marginally stable states. So marginally stable, again, means that if you look at the spectrum of the Hessian, this is gapless. So we have a lot of very soft directions in this minima. And OK, within the Cugliandolo-Kurchan scenario, you can compute a lot of properties, and you can characterize how the out-of-equilibrium dynamics behaves. So this is not the full story, because in more complicated models, so that are not like the spherical p-spin model, you don't have marginally stable states only in one point. But actually, you can have many manifolds of marginally stable states. And this is something that was recently discussed a lot by Fulena, Franz, and Rich Terzenghi. And it's a paper of 2019. Maybe it's published this year. And what they show is that actually, depending on the protocol that you use to quench your system, so here we discuss just a rapid quench, but you can do different things. For example, you can go down with temperature at a given rate, and then you can just quench the system. So if you change the protocol, actually, you can go below this point. And then you can land on different minima. But all of them are marginally stable. So this is something that you can check numerically. So you run those equations, you compute this thing, and then this thing is just equal to this. Okay. So marginal stability is really a guiding principle. So even if you don't know where you land in the energy landscape, you know that you land on those systems on minima that are marginally stable. Okay, that's one thing. And the other thing that I want to point out is that Here, marginal stability is deeply related to the behavior of the Hessian. So it's the Hessian that controls everything. So this is not the only case. You can have different version of marginal stability. And let me just tell you one. And there are much more complicated one that have come out looking at the jamming problem. And maybe I will discuss it next time. But let me just make a teaser. So imagine that you take again the p-spin. So you have again h that is but now you say, OK, let me take this that are easing spins. OK. So you change the problem from the hypersphere to the hypercube. So here you want to be on the hypersphere, and here you want to be on the hypercube. OK. Now, what's the equivalent of gradient descent here? Well, you just update your spins as the sign. Of the local field that they feel. OK, this is a time t. So it's a discrete time dynamics. So of course, if I am in a minimum, so the field that is felt by a spin is equal to the local field that is exerted by the neighboring ones. OK. So a good minimum is such that if I call this hi, sigma I of hi is greater than 0. And now what happens is that if you run these dynamics on this model, you discover that the minima that you can, where you can land, are such that if you look to this probability distribution of sigma I hi, let me call them ki. It's like this. And here it's linear. There is a linear slope. So what this is telling you is that you arrive into minima that are now minima on the hypercube. And all the excitations there, so if you want to move away from one minimum, you just need to flip a spin. And so if you have very small fields, local fields that act on those spins, then these spins are soft. And so they drive all the dynamics in the system. And so if you have a distribution of those quantities that looks like this, it means that you have just enough local fields. You have local fields that are just touching zero. Okay, so you are before of having an instability point. Okay, so this is. So I try to make a distinction between marginal stability, different form of marginal stability. So you have the linear one, or harmonic, where the physics of the problem is just controlled by the Hessian. So if you control the Hessian, you understand essentially the physics of the problem. And then there is the richer one, that is the nonlinear one. And here, the physics of the problem is controlled by nonlinear excitations. So for example, here you have spin flips. OK. Now you may say, okay, but you went from continuous variables to discrete ones. And okay, but we, so for the problems that we are interested in, we want to have continuous variables. And actually, this happens also for continuous variables. And indeed, what you have at jamming, it's this kind of marginal stability. Jamming of spheres. And in some models of one-hidden layer networks. Okay. Okay, can we use it? Can we use this in some settings? So let me just, before I go to an application of all those ideas. So we discussed this in the random setting. We want to have something that that has some kind of structure or signal. So let me finish with a big question that I think is super interesting and. There are few, I mean, the only result I think is the one of Kuliandl and Kurchan, which is a result for this case. So the big question is that, so as Florent was discussing, you need to have kind of unfrozen clusters of solutions. And in this context, unfrozen clusters are marginally stable ones. So in this fully connected setting, you can the physics is controlled by marginal stability. So you can make the conjecture that all local algorithms, either they run and they find the only minimum that is in the system, okay, or if they get stuck, they can get stuck on marginally stable states. So all local algorithms can find only marginally stable states. And those are the ones that are accessible to local dynamics. Of course, you can ask also if all marginally stable states are accessible to local dynamics. And is this true? And the reason is we believe it's not true, because there are models in which the landscape I'm drawing something that may be a bit wrong, but just to explain. So in this case here, in the case of the B-spin, we saw that you have marginally stable minima only there. But there are problems where there is a Gardner transition that is not the one of jamming, but it's another Gardner transition, where the landscape is such that it's like you have deep wells, so but then on the bottom, instead of having just a well-defined minimum, as in the P-spin case, you have marginally stable minima. So all those minima are marginally stable. And so in this case, you have marginally stable minima up to the Satansa transition point. But we believe that we cannot find them. And this is something that recently has attracted a lot of attention. And it's called, so if you look at the landscape of this problem, the ground state has what is called an overlap gap. Okay, so even if the bottom of this minima are marginally stable, you have very high barriers. This means that in order to find those minima, you need to fine-tune the dynamics in such a way that you fall inside these things. And typically, when you have this property in the Gibbs measure, it's believed that it's hard to get inside those minima. So the big question is how to characterize and to find marginally stable minima that the dynamics can find in polynomial time. And if you find the point where all those minima disappear, that would be the algorithmic transition point that Florent was discussing. Okay, so that's what happens when you have a really random landscape. And now I want to add a signal. Okay. I will go super fast. So now I want to consider the following inference problem that is called the spiked matrix tensor problem. And this is what Stefano studied a lot in his thesis. So you have So imagine that you have a signal that is extracted from the sphere again. We live on the sphere now. So it's n-dimensional. And then you want to measure this signal in some way. So what you do is that you construct a matrix. Plus some noise. And then you construct a tensor. Let me consider just a tree tensor. So what you do is that you measure two-point function and three-point function of the signal, but in a noisy way. So this noise is Gaussian with zero mean and variance delta 2. And this is Gaussian with zero mean and variance delta 3. OK? So given the matrix and the tensor, can we reconstruct X star? OK. So what we do is that you set up a base approach. So of course, the probability of having the signal X given the observations, and now I denote the observation as the matrix and the tensor, is just proportional to the probability of observing those observations given X times some prior over X. Okay, and now let me assume that the prior is the uniform measure over the sphere. Okay, so I know that, so I'm assuming here that I know this process. Okay, so I know the statistical properties of the noise, and these I will use here. And I know that the signal is on the sphere. Okay, So if you use this information, you can write this as the exponential minus 1 over 2 delta 2 Okay, so this is just due to the fact that the noise here is Gaussian. Okay, so if it's not Gaussian, it doesn't change much, but okay. So now, if you want to estimate the signal, what you can do is that you can sample this probability measure and say, okay, my estimator, I think it's x hat, it's the average value over this probability measure of x. Okay, so I have a measure over x, and then I want to compute this expectation value over this kind of Boltzmann measure, and this will give me an estimation of the signal. So this is sampling. Or what you can do is that you can say, okay, let me just try to find the minimum of this function. So that's where the probability has its maximum. So let me say that this is, okay. Let me say that this is e to the minus l. So try to estimate x as the argmin of l. Okay? And then you have a third class of algorithms that many of you know. That is, okay, you have a probability measure. Let's write down the approximate message passing for this problem. And this is another algorithm. So the third algorithm is x from AMP. Okay. And so AMP is the dense version of belief propagation that Florent was discussing. Okay. So how can you do this? So you want to sample this probability distribution in this case. So what you do is that you set up this. I think I need to run. Oops. So you say, okay, if I want to sample this measure, I set up a Langevin algorithm. So I use, again, a Lagrange multiplier to enforce the fact that I'm on the sphere. Eta i, and this eta I is average 0. Okay, so you know that on the long time limit, in the long time limit, this algorithm will sample this probability measure. On the other hand, if I want to solve this problem, the thing that I can do is that, okay, let me try to minimize minimize L by gradient descent. So I can just take, okay, so T is not there, it's 1, sorry. So let me try to do gradient descent. So I just forget about this. Okay, so you have two algorithms. One is sampling, and the other one is just doing gradient descent on this cost function L. Okay. So what's the relation with what we discussed? So let me compute L. So if I take its expression, I can just plug inside the matrix and the tensor the expression that they have in terms of the signal. So if I do, okay, just. So what you get, apart from constants, so let me call L tilde. So L tilde is equal to L apart from irrelevant constants. So this is 1 over delta 2. Two, three. And then I have a term that is cube. Okay. So you should recognize this part. So this is the three spin model, sorry. So this is a three spherical spin. Sorry, three spin. And this is the same model with p equal to 2. So it's what we discussed just before. Because these are Gaussian random couplings with the same scaling, with the right scaling with n. But you see that you have an additional term here that couples the configuration of the system with the actual signal. So these two terms are tilting the energy towards the minimum, the signal. Okay. And if these two noise levels are sufficiently low, this thing is going to destroy all the bad local minima coming from those terms that are completely unrelated with the signal. Okay, so you can set up a dynamical analysis of these two algorithms, so both for sampling and gradient descent, just using the same tool. So nothing changes, apart from the fact that so you have more equations, a bit more, because you have an equation for the magnetization. So you can think that this signal is tilting the configuration space towards one particular configuration. So let me call this the magnetization. Okay. So if this is high, it means that my configuration is correlated with the signal. And if it is zero, I'm just on the equator. This is what Gerard was discussing. So if you look to the equations, again, you will have the equation for C and R. So you will have, again, an equation for C. That is exactly the same as the one that we had before, but there is an additional term that comes from this. That is, so you just rewrite exactly the same thing that we wrote before, but you add a term that is q prime. And this q function is x cubed over 3 delta 3. Okay. So you have a dynamical equation for C, and now it depends on the dynamical magnetization. So how much the configuration x at time t is correlated with the signal. So this is m of t. So you have an equation for R that is exactly the same as before. And then you have an equation for m, okay? And this I write because you don't have. Now, imagine that you start from a random configuration. The initial condition is such that m of t is equal to 0. And so if you, so this mu is small because it's just the, I mean, you can just look at the equation, it's small. And so you see that this equation tells you that you have a kick in the magnetization that may come from this term, because even this term is small, because if t is small, this is harmless. So you can have three cases, and now I come to what Gérard was mentioning. So you have a case where Q prime of M of t is a constant. So you receive an enormous kick towards the signal. That's easy. Then you can have this that is linear. So it's a constant times M. And this is the critical regime. And then you can have higher terms, I don't know, k minus 2. And this is what Gérard was calling hard. So you see that why this is hard, because if m is small, this is like a contractive map. So you are not able to expand. Instead, here you start, the situation becomes easy, and in this case, it's critical. So in this case, you see, in the case that we are considering, we are right in this regime. Okay. Now let me discuss the phase diagram. So you can take the equations, integrate them, and then you can have a phase diagram. Okay. Okay. Do I have like 3 minutes? 2 minutes. Oh no. Okay. Okay, let me tell you about sampling. And here I plot 1 over delta 2. Now, I just drew the phase diagram, and then I will discuss. Okay, so in this region here, recovering the signal is impossible. This is the information theoretic transition. And here, in this region, AMP fails. So it's AMP hard. Above this line, AMP is able to recover the thing. So in this part, gives you the signal. So AMP gives you the signal. Now, if you integrate those equations, you can see what happens if you do Langevin. So you look at the magnetization. So you start from here, because here you have already an algorithm that tells you that recovering the signal is easy. So you look at the magnetization as a function of time. And if you are here, this thing does like this. So it starts from 0, and then poof, it jumps. And this is 1. It jumps to a plateau that is close to 1. So Langevin is recovering the signal. And now when you start from here and you decrease 1 over delta 2, so you are increasing the noise level in the matrix, fixing the noise level in the tree tensor. This does like this. And the most important thing is not that the plateau goes down, because it goes down a bit, but it's the fact that this time, the time where you have the jump, goes in this direction. Okay? So you recover the signal at longer and longer times as soon as you move this way. And actually, you can plot this relaxation time, so the time it takes to get the jump, as a function of 1 over delta 2. So here you have 1 over delta 2 critical. And this is a power law divergence, okay? So if you do it systematically on this phase diagram, you get a line here. That is where Langevin is not able to get to give you the signal anymore. So here, Langevin hard. This is Langevin hard. And here it's Langevin easy. Okay. Sorry? What do you mean? Yes, sorry. You're right. It's this. Okay. So this thing is something that is interesting, because it tells you that AMP is much better than Langevin. So it's it is able to find a way in which it can give you the signal regardless all these local minima that you have in the landscape. Instead, Langevin is deeply affected by all these local minima. Okay. So this is what happens for Langevin, and now let me discuss what happens if you do gradient descent. So now you remove the temperature in the problem. So you do exactly the same analysis. You look at the magnetization as a function of time, where it jumps. And then you get a line here. Okay, let me erase this. You already have. Okay. So this line is above this line, gradient descent is able to recover the signal. And now what you can do is that you can look at the trivialization transition, that is where the landscape becomes just one minimum. And this is there. Okay. So here the landscape is trivial. Here, in principle, you have many minima, but still gradient descent is able to recover the signal. And if you do Langevin, you can even move, you can even improve. Okay. So this is something that we observed with Stefano, Florent, myself, and Lenka. And this is in ICML 2019, to remember. 19. And then Stefano, Giulio, Chiara, Florent, and Lenka in Noritz. So they came up with an argument that is the following. So imagine that you are here. In order to understand where this transition is, you say, okay, let me come from here or from there. This is the R phase for gradient descent, for example. So here, I'm not able to go to the signal. So I land on this marginally stable minimum. And so they trap the dynamics, and they stay there. Now, it may happen that when you look at the contribution of this signal to the Hessian, you have a kind of BBP phenomenon, such that the Hessian gets a negative eigenvalue whose eigenvector is correlated with the signal. And if you compute this, you match this line. Okay. So there are two take-home messages. So the first one is that the trivialization transition is different from the transition where GD is able to recover the signal. And then, so this is kind of generic in the sense that even if you have a different version of marginal stability that is not linear, so it's not controlled by the Hessian, you can think that this may happen. And then in the case in which the marginal stability is linear, so everything is controlled by the Hessian, so this transition, this GD, is equal to a BBP phenomenon for threshold states. Okay. So of course, if you move away from p-spin, spherical p-spin, and you go to more complicated models, for example, Gerard was mentioning sparse PCA or Z2 synchronization or things like that, then of course the version of marginal stability that you have is different. And you can have different mechanisms. So this one is an example in which you can use the fact that that you land on marginally stable states, and then you can use them as a proxy to control the physics. And so these two messages are, I think are important and can be found in many problems of the same kind. It's over.